Hi students, welcome back to GDC classes. This is another session of the RRB Tejas series, and in this session we will try to solve MCQs on the topics sensory organs and also the skeletal system under the human anatomy and physiology. So let us start. So the first question, name the part of the eye which is involved in focusing light on the retina. So the light, the images, they fall onto the retina. Retina is the sensory part of the eye. So which part of the eye will help in focusing the light onto the retina? Is it the sclera, iris, cornea, or the ciliary muscles? So the answer is cornea. Cornea is the, the outermost part of the eye. Okay, it is the outermost part of the eye which will help in focusing the light onto the retina. So here are the parts of the eye. Here what the cornea is doing, it allows for the passage of the light into the eye and it also focuses the light onto the retina. The cornea, in the middle of the cornea, it has a small opening called pupil. So the light, when it enters the cornea, it crosses through the pupil, it moves through the pupil and it will be focused onto the retina. Then next question, the receptors which are sensitive to taste and smell are called fronts, anthers, chemoreceptors and cones. The answer is chemoreceptors. So these chemoreceptors, they are present in the medulla oblongata. Both smell and taste use chemoreceptors, which essentially means they are sensing the chemical environment, and these are present in the medulla oblongata of the brain. And particularly if we talk about the smell, the taste, we have taste buds, right? You might be familiar with the taste buds on the tongue. They will help us to identify different tastes of food like sweet, sour, bitter, salt taste. So these taste buds will help us with detecting the taste, and that information will be sent to the brain. And also coming to the smell, the olfactory nerves, they will send the information about the smell to the brain. Next question, cochlea is the part of. So cochlea, it is a part of the ear, and particularly the cochlea is present in which part of the ear? The options are internal ear, middle ear, endolymphatic sac, or the brain. So the cochlea is present in the internal ear. Here the parts of the ear, they are divided into three: the outer ear, the middle ear and the inner ear. Outer ear has the ear pinna, which is a cartilage. Okay, here you can see this part is known as the ear auricle or the cartilage. It helps in collecting the sound waves into the ear canal. Ear canal means it is the auditory tube, auditory canal. It directs the sound waves to the middle ear, to the eardrum. And middle ear, it consists of the eardrum, ear ossicles, oval window and also the round window. Eardrum, it vibrates and passes the vibrations to the ossicles. So when the sound vibrations enter the external ear, it passes through the auditory tube. Then it touches the eardrum, which is also known as the tympanic drum. And this drum, it vibrates, which in turn vibrates the ear ossicles. So ear ossicles, there are three pairs of ear ossicles in our body. So one pair will be present in the right eye, one pair will be present in the left eye. And what are the ossicles? The malleus, the incus and the stapes. And oval windows, it will transfer the vibration of the sound to the cochlea, which is present in the inner part of the ear. So cochlea changes the vibrations of the sound into nerve impulses, and these nerve impulses, they are transmitted by the auditory nerve to the brain. Okay, cochlea will transfer the vibrations of the sound into electrical impulses, and the auditory nerve, it will carry the electrical impulses to the brain. And now the brain will interpret the sound. So what sound it is, what the person is talking, what is the sound we are hearing. So the brain will interpret all those things. Next question, color perception in man is due to. So how the human is able to perceive the color? How do we know that a particular thing is blue, green, yellow or violet? How do we know that? So options are rhodopsin present in the cone cells, iodopsin present in the cone cells, rhodopsin present in the rod cells, or iodopsin present in the rod cells. So what is the correct option? Iodopsin. Iodopsin present in the cone cells are responsible for the ability to perceive color. So there are two types of photoreceptor cells in our eyes. One is the cones and the other one is the rods. Cones are the, you know, they are bright light, or you can say daylight photoreceptors, whereas rods are night light photoreceptors. The rods, they can they will provide us the ability to see the things also in the dim light, whereas cone cells, they will help us to see the bright light, see the things in bright light. They will provide us with the color vision, whereas the rods, they will help us to see in the dim light, and it is non-color vision. And also the rods are present in numerous number in our eyes. So coming to the cones have a thing called iodopsin. So this will help us to percept the color, whereas the rods, they have a thing called iodopsin. Remember. Next question, the innermost layer of the human eye is called sclera, cornea, choroid or retina. So we know the answer, right? It is the retina. Retina is the innermost layer of the eye. So eye is divided into three layers. The outermost layer, it is known as the fibrous layer. The middle layer is the vascular layer, or you can call it as the tunic. Okay, three layers or three tunics. The fibrous tunic, the vascular tunic, and then the sensory tunic. The fibrous tunic, it has the cornea and the choroid. Sorry, the cornea and the sclera. So cornea is the round structure and sclera is the white part of the eye. And middle vascular layer, that is the vascular tunic, it has the choroid, the iris, and also the ciliary muscles. And the innermost layer, it consists of the retina. So this retina, it is very sensitive to the light, and it converts the light rays into impulses, and these impulses will be carried by the optic nerve to the brain. So just like the auditory nerve, which carries the sound impulses to the brain, the optic nerve, it carries the light impulses or the vision impulses to the brain. Now next, color blindness is due to the defect in. So color blindness means it is a condition in which a person will not be percept colors. Everything will be in black and white. They won't be able to differentiate or percept colors. And why it will happen? The defect in cones or rods and cones or the rhodopsin. So what is the answer? It is the cones. So I have told you earlier, cones have the cones have the color percepting protein, right? The iodopsin. So here I will show you again. So cones have iodopsin, which will help in percepting the colors. So if there is any defect in the cones, the person won't be able to differentiate between colors. Cone cells or cones or a type of photoreceptor cells, they are present in the retina of the eye and are responsible for color vision as well as the eye color sensitivity. And cones are less sensitive to light than rod cells. So the rod cells, they are more sensitive to light and less sensitive to color, whereas the cones are more sensitive to color and less sensitive to light. Color blindness, it is a reduced ability to distinguish between colors, and it is a very common defect, and it will occur because of a defect in the cones that are present in the retina of the eye. Next question, the ciliary body is a part of which of these following structures? So ciliary body is a structure in the eye, and it is a part of which structure? Choroid, retina, sclera, or macula lutea? The answer is choroid. So this ciliary body, I'll show you, these are the ciliary body structures. This ciliary body, it will extend backwards to form the choroid. So this layer, this brown color layer you are seeing, this is the choroid layer. So the middle layer of the eyeball is known as choroid, which is rich in blood vessels. So the vascular layer, has the choroid, which is an extension of the ciliary body. So choroid is an extension of the ciliary body and it is very rich in blood vessels. The ciliary body is a part of the choroid. And what are the functions of the ciliary body? It will help. It will help in adjusting the size of the lens. So this is the lens here, and this is the ciliary body. These are ciliary processes. It will help in adjusting the size of the lens. And what is the function of the lens? It will focus the light onto the retina. It will bend the light and focus it onto the retina. Next question. And also another major function of the ciliary body is that it will produce the aqueous fluid, like the aqueous humor, the vitreous humor. It is produced by the ciliary body. So here, in front of the lens, aqueous humor will be present, and behind the lens, in this area, vitreous humor will be present. Remember. Next question. Complete loss of smell is also called as anosmia, hyposmia, hyperosmia, none of the above. So the answer is complete loss of smell. It is anosmia. So anosmia is a total loss of sensation of smell. Hyposmia, it is reduced ability to recognize or detect any odor or smell. Hyperosmia, it is an increased or exaggerated olfactory sensation. Next, which is the smallest facial bone? So our head, it has cranial bones and the facial bones. Among the facial bones, which is the smallest one? Vomer bone, zygomatic bone, mandibular bone, or lacrimal bone? The answer is lacrimal bone. So lacrimal bone is the smallest bone among the facial bones. The lacrimal bone is the most fragile bone of the face and it is one of the smallest bones in the body. It is spanning between the middle of each eye socket. So it is present in the eye socket and it provides support to the lacrimal ducts. Okay, it will help in the formation of lacrimal ducts. So these are the facial bones here. Nasal bone, one pair of nasal bone, a pair of lacrimal bone, inferior nasal conchae, maxillary bone, mandibular bone, vomer bone, zygomatic bone, that is the cheekbones, and the palatine bone. So these are the facial bones, and facial bones are 14. So facial bones are 14. Next question. The hollow space in the middle of the bones is filled with air, blood, bone cells, or bone marrow. So this is an easy question, right? The middle of the bone, the medullary cavity of the bone, what it has? It has the bone marrow. Okay, bone marrow is found in the centermost bones and has many blood vessels. There are two types of bone marrow, the yellow bone marrow and the red bone marrow. So red bone marrow, it contains all the blood stem cells, and so the red bone marrow, it has stem cells which will produce the red blood cells, the platelets, the white blood cells. These and all will be produced from the bone marrow. And the yellow bone marrow, it is present, it is mostly fat. Okay, and the red bone marrow, it has the blood stem cells. So you can see here, this is the yellow bone marrow. This is the red bone marrow. So as the age proceeds, adults have more yellow bone marrow, but the red bone marrow is only confined to the epiphyseal plates. So here, this region is the epiphyseal plate, and the red bone marrow is present mostly in these epiphyseal plates. And here and all, the yellow bone marrow will be present in adults. But in case of infants, the medullary cavity of the bone will also have the red bone marrow. Next question: which of the following cells are responsible for the skin color? So the skin color changes, right, varies according to the place that we live in. So which cells are responsible for the skin color? Melanocytes, keratinocytes, Merkel cells, or Langerhans cells? The answer is melanocytes. So these melanocytes, they are present in the skin layers. So skin layers, three main layers. There are three main layers in the skin: the epidermis, the dermis, and the hypodermis. Again, the epidermis is subdivided into five layers: the stratum basal layer, stratum spinosum, stratum granulosum, stratum lucidum, and stratum corneum. In the stratum basal layer of the epidermis, the melanocytes are present, and these melanocytes, they contain a pigment called melanin. So this melanin is responsible for the pigment or the color of the skin. And also this melanin acts as a natural sunscreen. Okay, when UVB light falls on the skin, the melanin secretion is stimulated. And also it acts as a natural sunscreen for the UV light. And other things, the keratinocytes, these are also the cells present in the skin layers, and they have a protein called keratin. Okay, and Merkel cells and Langerhans cells, these cells, Merkel cells, they are the cells which are sensitive for touch. Okay, Merkel cells, they are also present in the skin layers, which are sensitive for touch, whereas Langerhans cells, they help their function is to kill any bacteria or pathogen that tries to enter the body through the skin. Then which of the following is not a bone of the axial skeleton? So our skeletal system, it has two types of skeletons. One is the axial skeleton and the other one is the appendicular skeleton. So in the axial skeleton, which is not found among the following? The pectoral girdles, ethmoid bone, sphenoid bone, and hyoid bone. So the answer is pectoral girdles. So axial skeleton, what does it have? It has the skull, the middle ear, hyoid bone, vertebral column, and the ribcage. So the middle part, the skull, the hyoid bone, the ear ossicles, the vertebral column in the back, and the ribcage. So these will form the axial skeleton, whereas the appendicular skeleton constitutes of the pelvic girdles, pectoral girdles, and the limbs, the hand limbs and the legs, the hands and the legs. The skull has 22 bones, 14 facial bones, and 8 bones in the skull. Sphenoid and ethmoid bone are present in the cranium of the skull. Middle ear, it has 6 bones, 3 in each ear. Hyoid bone, this is the jawbone, is the hyoid bone. And vertebral column, it has 26 bones. The cervical, thoracic, coccygeal bone, sacral bone, like that. And then the ribcage has 25 bones. The axial skeleton, in total, it has 80 bones. Then coming to the appendicular skeleton, it has 126 bones. The pectoral girdles, which have 4 bones. The pelvic girdle, which has 2 bones. Then the upper limbs having 60 bones and the lower limbs having another 60 bones. So total we have 206 bones. Now tendons and ligaments. What are these tendons and ligaments? They are muscular tissue, connective tissue, skeletal tissue, or fibrous connective tissue. So what is the answer? It is a fibrous connective tissue. Tendons are the ones which attach a muscle to a bone. Okay, the fibrous tissue which attaches a muscle to a bone is known as the tendon. And a tissue which attaches a bone to a bone, it is known as the ligament. Remember, this is very important. Next question, which taste bud is present on the lateral sides of the tongue? So the taste buds present on the lateral sides, so on the sides of the tongue, are able to perceive which taste? So salty, sweet, bitter or sour? The answer is sour taste. So here the back of the tongue can perceive bitter taste, the lateral back side of the tongue can perceive sour taste, and the anterior lateral sides of the tongue can perceive salty taste, and the sweet taste can be perceived by the tip of the tongue. So there are taste buds, right? There are different types of taste buds on our tongue. The filiform, fungiform, circumvallate and foliate. The filiform, okay, the filiform, they are present on the anterior side. So here they are present. The filiform, they are present on the tip. Circumvallate are present on the back side of the tongue. And the foliate, they are present on the back lateral sides of the tongue. So filiform, fungiform, circumvallate and the foliate taste buds. Next, complete loss of taste sensation is called hypogeusia, agusia, dysgeusia or none of the above. It is agusia. Complete loss of taste sensation is known as agusia. Hypogeusia is the decrease in taste sensation. Taste blindness. So it is a rare genetic disorder in which the ability to recognize the taste of the food will be lost. And dysgeusia means it is a disturbance in taste sensation. Next question. Which bone protects the brain? The cranium, the cerebellum or the cerebrum, the calcium. So obvious, right? It is the cranium. So cranium of the skull will protect the brain. And the cranium of the brain, it has different bones, right? The frontal bone, the sphenoid bone, the ethmoid bone, parietal bone, temporal bone and the occipital bone. Cranial bones, how many are there? Temporal 2, parietal 2, occipital 1, frontal 1, sphenoid 1 and ethmoid 1. So 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So these sphenoid and the ethmoid bone, these are a part of the facial bones. Whereas the frontal bone, parietal bone, temporal bone and the occipital bone, these are the skull bones or the cranial bones, which are 8. Next, the impulse of the sound is conducted to the brain by. So the sound signals are passed to the brain by what nerve? Olfactory, auditory, trochlea or optic nerve? So the answer is auditory nerve. Olfactory nerve, it will send the smell, impulses associated to the smell. Auditory, it will send impulses associated to the sound. Optic nerve associated to the vision. Okay. And trochlear nerve, it is the nerve which will help the help in the movement of the eyeballs. Okay. We will be able to look down sides because of the trochlear nerve. And then where is the image of an object formed in the human eye? Cornea, pupil, retina or the iris? So answer, it is obviously the retina. Retina is the sensory tunic or the innermost layer of the eye onto which the images or the lights are focused. Okay, mechanism, light enters the eye through the cornea and iris and pupil will regulate the amount of light entering the eye. Iris, in the cornea, the colored portion of the cornea is the iris. And a small hole in the cornea, it is the pupil. So the iris and the pupil will regulate the amount of light entering or amount of light that is being focused on the retina. The image is then focused through the lens onto the retina. So the lens this is the lens. The lens will bend the light and it will help in focusing the light onto the retina. The pigmented choroid darkens the interior of the eye. So choroid, this brown layer here, it is the choroid layer. So what this choroid will do when light enters into the inner part of the eye, if any light scatters, the choroid will absorb those scattered light. So it will provide a dark environment inside the light, inside the eye, so that the images or the light can be focused directly onto the retina, preventing the scattering of the light inside the eye. The image then stimulates the receptors present in the cones and rods of the retina. So then the cones and rods present in the retina will be stimulated, and then these impulses will be carried through the optic nerve to the brain. Next question. Skin remains soft by the supply of sebum that is secreted by. So the skin has the melanocytes, keratinocytes, sweat glands, and also another type of gland. So what is that? The sebaceous gland. So sebaceous glands are the ones present in the skin which secrete a substance called sebum. So this sebum, it is an oily substance which will try to keep the skin layer moist. Okay, it also protects the skin from drying out. So these sebum, these are the sebaceous glands. They will secrete sebum onto the surface so that the skin, you can prevent the skin from drying out. Next, in myopia, the image is formed. So myopia is an eye condition. Generally, the image is formed on the retina. But in myopia, where the image is formed? On the retina, behind the retina, in front of the retina, or none of the above? So the answer is in front of the retina. Myopia, also known as short-sightedness. So in this condition, the distant objects cannot be seen clearly. So if an object is present in a very far distance from us, we will not be able to, a person suffering from myopia will not be able to see that image clearly. And hypermetropia is a long-sightedness in which the near objects cannot be seen properly. And presbyopia, it occurs in old age due to the loss of elasticity of the lungs. So lens, they will increase and decrease in their size. So they will adjust their size in order to focus the light on the retina. So if they lose their elasticity, then the light cannot be focused properly onto the retina. So that is the presbyopia. Glaucoma is a condition which occurs when the pressure within the eye increases. So there is some fluids in the eye, right? The aqueous humor and the vitreous humor. And if these fluids, they are not, if they are secreted in large amounts and they are not drained properly, then the fluid within the eye will build up. Because of this, the pressure within the eye builds up, and this high pressure will damage the optic nerve. So this will cause blindness. So that condition, the damage to the optic nerve because of the increase in pressure within the eye is known as glaucoma. And color blindness, as we know, it is a defect to the cones present in the retina. Next question. Which of these joints do not show any movement? So there are different joints in our body, right? The fibrous joint, cartilaginous joint, ball and socket joint, pivot joint, hinge joint. So among these, which doesn't show any movement? The fibrous joint, synovial joint, pivot joint, or the cartilaginous joint? Answer is the fibrous joint. Okay, fibrous joint, examples are bones of the skull. So the temporal bone, the frontal bone, parietal bone, and the occipital bone, they are stick to each other and they don't move, right? They don't move. So that is the fibrous, those are known as the fibrous joints, and also the bones of the pulvic girdle. So here these bones, the ilium, ischium, these are the bones of the pulvic girdles, and also they don't show any movement. So coming to the other options, the synovial joint, it is present in the knee, right? The synovial joint, it shows movement. And also the pivot joint, it is present here in the neck region, so we can move our head. And cartilaginous joint, it is present in the vertebral column. So each vertebra is attached to the another vertebra by some cartilage tissue in between. Next, the upper limb consists of how many bones? Upper limb, 26, 31, 14, or 60? The answer is 60. So here, the arm, this is the upper limb. The appendicular skeleton, as we know, it has 126 bones. The pectoral girdles here, this is the scapular bone, this is the clavicle bone, this is the humerus bone. Okay, these three bones constitute the pectoral girdle, and they have four bones. Pectoral girdles have four bones, and the pelvic girdle, they have two bones. So this is one bone and this is one bone. And pectoral girdle, it has one clavicle, one scapula on one side, and another clavicle and another scapula on the other side. So it makes four bones. And in the pelvic girdle, we have two bones. Upper limb, we have 60 bones, and the lower limb, another 60 bones. So upper limb, what are the bones present? The humerus, the radius, the ulna, and the carpals. In the legs, we have the femur, tibia, fibula, and then the tarsals, tarsals and metatarsals. So the limbs have 60 bones each. Okay, upper limbs, sorry, 60 bones in both the limbs. So 30 in one limb, 30 in another limb. Next question, how many facial bones does the skull possess? So how many facial bones? 14. So skull has 22 bones. Among that, 8 are cranial bones and 14 are facial bones. Next question, which of these structures has alternate dark and light bands on it? Fascicles, sarcolemma, myofibrils, or fascia? What is the answer? It is myofibrils. So myofibrils are nothing but the muscle fibers. Okay, they contain filaments in its sarcoplasm, which are arranged in parallel manner. So you can see alternate dark and light bands. What is the function of the myofibril? It is to produce muscle contraction and relaxation. So these myofibrils, they will help in the contraction and relaxation of the muscles. Next question. Which of the following is a bone that is embedded within a tendon? Options: sphenoid bone, hyoid bone, ethmoid bone, and sesamoid bone. So sesamoid bone. So tendon, what is a tendon? It is a tissue which will attach the muscle to a bone. So the question is asking, what is the bone that is embedded within the tendon? So the answer is sesamoid bone. So here you can see these sesame like bones, they are present within the tendon. So where they are present in the foot, the hand, and also in the patella. Patella means the knee bone. Next question. Freely movable joints are also known as fibrous joints, cartilaginous joints, amphiarthrosis, or synovial joints. What is the answer? Synovial joints. So synovial joint bones are freely movable. So there are three types of joints. Based on their movement, they are classified into three types. One is synarthrosis, amphiarthrosis, and diarthrosis. So synarthrosis joints, they don't show any movement. Examples are the bones of the skull and also the bones of the pelvic girdle. And amphiarthrosis means they can show some movement. Examples are vertebral column. Okay, the vertebral column cannot stretch very much. They can stretch up to some extent. And also the ribs, the ribcage bones are attached to the sternum by the help of hyaline cartilage. And also freely movable joints, which are diarthrosis joints, they show good movement, like the synovial joints, ball and socket joint, like that. So synarthrosis or fibrous joints, amphiarthrosis or cartilaginous joints, and diarthrosis or synovial joints. Next, which of the following bones is a part of the cranium? So the cranium has 8 bones. Among these, which is a part of the cranial bone? Occipital, mandibular, hyoid, and carpal. It is definitely the occipital bone. So the mandibular bone, it is the jawbone. Hyoid bone, it is a bone which is present in the neck region. It will support the tongue. Okay, it supports the tongue, the hyoid bone. And carpal bone, it is present in the palm. So these are the cranial bones. Next question. Which of the following is a moving skull bone? So, which bone in the skull has the ability to move? Femur, mandible, atlas, and tibia. The answer is mandible, of course, right? The femur is a bone which is present in the legs. Atlas is a bone of the vertebral column and sorry, in the neck region here. And tibia is also a bone present in the legs. Mandibular bone, we can move the mandibular bone. It is a jawbone. Next question, which is the longest and strongest bone of the body? Humerus, radius, femur, ulna. The answer is femur. So femur is the longest bone and also the strongest bone present in the legs. And along with the femur, tibia and fibula are present. But femur is the longest and the strongest bone present in the legs. And humerus is the bone present in the hands, along with the radius and ulna. These three bones are present in hands, but the femur is present in the legs. Next question, which one of the following is a sesamoid bone? The pectoral girdle, pterygoid, pelvis, patella. The answer is patella bone. So the knee bone is also known as the sesamoid bone because of its appearance like a sesame seed. And that is the questions on the sensory organs and the skeletal system. And we will try to solve some more questions on another topic in next session. Thank you.